Good evening. On behalf of the Congregation of St. Paul's United Church of Christ, I'd like to welcome you to our Facebook Live service. We are grateful that you are able to join us, and we're thankful for your presence. We were a little delayed because of some technical difficulties. I did hear that there were rumors floating around that we had so many people coming in to get their ashes that we had a long line and we had to wait till everybody's finished. As much as that would be nice to say, that wasn't true. But we did have a number of people that came by today, and it was wonderful to be able to see people. It was wonderful to be able to offer this to members of our congregation. It's something that I think we might even try to do next year or coming years and open that up even wider to members, other members of the community who might want to come by. But we're grateful you are with us this evening. One reminder, we will be celebrating Holy Communion, so if you do not have any bread or wine or grape juice with you at the moment, and you would like to go get some, we encourage you to do that so you can participate with us later in the service. There is a poem. Those of you who received the bulletin and have printed it out, or if you're looking on your computer at this, there's a poem at the end of the liturgy. That's not a part of the liturgy. You can miss it. It's for your enjoyment, something to read afterwards, something to read over the course of Lent. There's also another poem that's a part of the liturgy that we will be reading during the course of this evening. We include all the words because we do think they're wonderful words and that you might enjoy reading those as you go forward during this journey in Lent. And so we encourage you to hold on to these and make use of them during this season. Now I'd ask that we might together join in the responsive call to worship. You will find these words in your bulletin. Friends and neighbors, in the middle of our busy week, we pause to observe Ash Wednesday together as a faith community. We come to remember that God made us from fragile, blessed dust, and breathes through us the breath of life and love. From dust we are created in God's image, and to God's good dust we shall return. With dust and oil we claim the mark of God's beloved creatures. On this night we begin our 40-day Lenten journey to again seek to discover who we are created to be as God's beloved. In daily practices of prayer and service, we will embark upon this Lenten journey. We follow Jesus, God's beloved child, bone of our bone and flesh of our flesh, in whom we see God's image most clearly. So come, let us pray for strength and imagination to follow Jesus wherever he will lead us this Lent.
Thank you. let's join together in the responsive prayer of invocation and confession. Glorious God, your thoughts are not our thoughts, neither are your ways our ways. You look at the ugliest soul and see, still unstirred, the wings of an angel. We stand the finest of our neighbors, anxious upon my fall. You view time in the context of eternity, and so find a place for waiting, for yearning, even for suffering, even for dying.
We demand instant results, and look for tomorrow before savoring today.
You know that only one who suffers can ultimately save. That is why you walk the way of the cross.
We fear that vulnerability, which defies our power, and so we cry for crucifixion.
Your thoughts are not our thoughts, O God.
Neither are your ways our ways.
And yet we know your way is life lived in community with all, while, left to our own devices, we focus solely on ourselves. But we are here not to have our worst confirmed, but to have our best liberated. So we pray,
forgive us what has gone wrong, repair in us what is wasted, reveal in us what is good,
and nourish us with better food than we could ever purchase. Your word, your love, your inspiration, your daily bread for our life's journey, in the company of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As we lay down what is past, we sense God's forgiveness, a forgiveness that is always there and there for all people. We lay down what is past and look to the future. We take into our daily life signs of hope and healing. We reach beyond ourselves and seek connection. We seek to share our lives with others, touching and reshaping the wider world so it more reflects God's dream. Amen. As a sign of our reconciliation with God and with one another, please turn to whomever you are with and pass the peace of Christ. Peace be with you. Peace. Peace be with you all.
God is still speaking.
Thanks be to God.
The Hebrew scripture reading for this evening comes from the 58th chapter of Isaiah. Shout out. Do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce for my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? Look, you serve your own interest on your fast day and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such the fast that I choose? A day to humble yourself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? Have you seen the naked to cover them, and not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and God will say, "Here I am." If you remove the yoke from among you, pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall shine in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in worse places, and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. If you refrain from trampling the Sabbath, from pursuing your own interests on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight and the holy day of the Lord honorable, if you honor it, not going your own ways, serving your own interests, or pursuing your own affairs, then you shall take delight in the Lord, and I will make you ride on the heights of the earth. I will feed you with the heritage of your ancestor Jacob. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Here is the reading of the Hebrew Scripture. The gospel lesson for this evening is from the 6th chapter of Matthew's gospel. Listen for the words of God. Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your God who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces so as to show others that they are fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father, who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume, and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth more rust consumed, and where thieves will not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Here in these readings, may God anoint our hearing and living of these words. Amen.
I remember once speaking with a gentleman, and I asked him if he was coming to the Ash Wednesday service we were having that evening, and he said to me, why would I want to go to a service where I'm reminded that I'm going to die? And it sort of took me back, because that wasn't necessarily how I thought about an Ash Wednesday service. But on reflection, I could see why he might think that way. We have ashes as the central focus, or one of the central focuses of the service. If we are placing ashes on someone's head or on the back of their hands, like we did during the course of the day today, or we usually do during the course of the service, we say, remember you are dust, and to dust you shall return. This reminder that we will die. But then I realized that Ash Wednesday is much more. There's much more to it than that. Yet death is a part of it. A big part of what we are remembering tonight, what we are celebrating even tonight, is a reminder of who and what and whose we are. Remember you are dust. Remember how we are told of our creation, how human beings came into being. Now, you don't have to believe this is literally true, but what the writers were attempting to get across was that we humans were created out of the earth, Adam in Hebrew, and we were made into an earth person, earth child, Adama. We're so closely related to the earth. We're so connected. Adam and Adama. And we're reminded of that on this evening. We're dirt. We're dust. We're nothing more than that, but also nothing less than that. Dirt and dust, where our food comes from, where life springs from. We are as important as that. And we're also reminded that in order for Adama, the earth person, the earth child, to come fully to life, that God breathes into them. We, each person, each and every person, are dust that contains God's breath, contains a part of the holy, and that breath never leaves us until we take our final one. So it is always with us. So this is a reflection on the whole of our lives from the beginning to the end. It's not something we always like to think about. It's not something we always want to talk about. It scares us. We don't necessarily like to be reminded that we are a little more than dust. We don't necessarily like to be reminded that there will come a point in time in which we'll die. But if we don't remember those things, then it's very hard for us to live our lives as fully as possible. It's very hard for us to live our lives as we were created to live them. We do wonderful things, but sometimes we don't. We create wonderful things, cameras and sound systems and computers, and sometimes they just don't work. Is it the end of the world? No, it's not. Sometimes we feel like it is, but that's not how life works. We adapt. We figure out what we can do differently. We see how we can maybe fix this, and we go on. We continue to listen to what that breath of God inside us is speaking to us, what it's calling us to do, what it's calling us, the ways that it's calling us to act. Sometimes we hear that right away, sometimes we hear it later on, further down along the line. There's no telling. But the breath, God's breath, never leaves us. It's always with us. It always speaks to us. It's always seeking to remind us who we are and whose we are. Beloved children of God. You may have noticed that Reverend Karen got a little choked up as she was reading the scripture. Now that's not because she hasn't read scripture for a while. She's done it often enough that is now something she's very comfortable with. It turns out that passage, the Isaiah 58 passage, is the passage that was read and preached at her ordination. When people are called to ministry, when we move towards ordination, a part of that process is seeking to understand that we're God's and God has called us to be doing some specific work in the world. To turn injustice into justice. To feed the hungry. To say what's wrong around us and seek to repair it. When we answer that sort of call, every time we hear those words, we're reminded that we've remembered who we are and we're doing our best to answer the call. Maybe it's a wonder you just didn't break down and cry. We know Reverend Karen's been doing that for the past 20 plus years. We know in part because of our particular personal experiences with her and others who share the same thing. Remembering who we are, listening for God's call, and responding to that call, that's what God asks of us. And it can be hard to do. It can be hard to step away from our normal busy lives and remember that we have to take time to do that. And you know, sometimes it's just not clear. Sometimes it gets a little messy and fuzzy and uncertain, sort of like the cross on my forehead right now. Allyssa did the imposition of ashes on my forehead at first thing this morning in our first round at somewhere between 7:30 and 9 o'clock. It got cold enough, we sort of lost track of what time it actually was out there. But over the course of the day, you know, you're focusing on things, and you rub your head, or you do something, you rub up against something, and the next thing you know, that cross that was so clearly there on your forehead is smudged, and you wonder, what is that dark spot? It's still a cross. It's still there to remind us. But we have to look a little more carefully. We have to take the time to remember, oh yes, that's what's there. And I chose to have that put on my forehead because I want to remember. I want to be reminded that I need to continue to listen to what God's breath within inside of me is saying to me. Reminding me of what my call is. Reminding me to encourage each and every other person to listen for theirs and to respond to it. Ash Wednesday is far from a service about death. It's a service about life and how we might best live it. And it's a reminder that Lent is a time in which we can reflect on that. Choose to reflect on that specifically. Let us make the choice to begin this journey. And even though we were scattered geographically at the moment, we make the journey together. And we are all connected. We are connected because we're all dirt, we're all earth and dust. And we all have the breath of God within us. Let us remember. This table is adorned for our Lent journey. It contains elements that are to be reminders that we are on a journey, that it is a journey that will not always be easy. It is a journey that is filled with light and with calls. It is a journey that includes being asked to pick up our crosses when called upon. This table is also set with the elements of Holy Communion. There's been long arguments as to who should be allowed to participate in the gifts of this table. People can argue away. This table is open. It's open for all who wish to participate in the mystery and power of this meal, of this sacrament, of all who are willing to partake and to say, I remember that I am God's, and I wish to fulfill God's call to me. And I believe that as I take bread and as I drink wine or juice, I am empowered to do that. If you so desire, join with us. Join with us wherever you are, with the bread you have, and the juice and the wine that you have. Let us take this journey together. And also with you.
Gracious God, we praise you and give you thanks.
It is good and right to give God our thanks and praise.
For the love we name, creating God and all that is, for the one we name, Jesus, and his message of peace, justice, and inclusiveness that is the realm of God, for the renewing strength and freedom of the Spirit, always present in the breath of life.
We give you thanks for God's presence in the midst of life.
Let us pray. Loving God, through your goodness we have this bread and wine and grape juice to offer, which has come forth from the earth and human hands have made. May we know your presence in the sharing, so that we may know your touch and presence in all things. We celebrate the life that Jesus has shared among his community through the centuries and shares with us now. Made one in Christ and one with each other, we offer these gifts and with them ourselves, a single living act of praise. We spread your table with these gifts of the earth and of our labor. We ask that you send your Holy Spirit on the bread, on the wine and the juice, the elements on this table and on every table set before you. We ask that you send your Holy Spirit on our gifts and on us. Be present with us as we share this meal and throughout all our lives, that we may know you as the Holy One, who with Christ and the Holy Spirit lives forever. We offer you this prayer and all our prayers in your gracious and holy name, and in the name of Jesus the Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We remember the stories, how Jesus gathered with friends and foes to tell them of a reimagined way of living and being, a way that did not conform to the standards of the Roman Empire or any other system of governance that suppressed people until starvation and deprivation resulted in death.
In this way, the issues of life and death, justice and injustice, conflict and peace, goodness and evil, were talked through and made real to ordinary people.
So in our time and in this place, with today's issues before us, let us continue the tradition to break bread together. We remember what that tradition says. At the end of the journey,
Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks for it, he blessed it, and then he broke it. And he said, "This bread is broken, as my body will be." And he handed it to his friends and invited them to eat. "Remember all that I have been to you." We remember.
We recall how Jesus poured a cup of wine. Offered thanks for it and gave it to his friends. "This wine is poured out as my life will be. As you drink, give thanks for all I have given." We give thanks.
Real food and real drink, reminding us we are asked to offer, to give our real lives.
These are the gifts of God. They are for the people of God. Come, for all is ready. Gracious God, we thank you for your presence within us. Your Spirit is a source of healing, wisdom, and inspiration. During our Lenten journey, we pray your Spirit may strengthen us when we feel weak, warm us when we are cold-hearted, bend us when we are stubborn, move us when we are uncaring, and guide us in the way of love. May your Spirit shine in all we do. Amen.
Thank you. Blessing the Dust by Jan Richardson. All those days, you felt like dust, like dirt, as if all you had to do was turn your face toward the wind and be scattered to the four corners, or swept away by the smallest breath as insubstantial. Did you not know what the Holy One can do with dust?
This is the day we freely say we are scorched. This is the hour we are marked by what has made it through the burning. This is the moment we ask for the blessing that lives within the ancient ashes, that makes its home in the soil of this sacred earth.
So let us be marked, not for sorrow, and let us be marked, not for shame. Let us be marked not for false humility or for thinking we are less than we are, but for claiming what God can do within the dust, within the dirt, within the stuff of which the world is made, and the stars that blaze in our bones, and the galaxies that spiral inside the smudge we bear.
Blessings like God's love are not one-way experiences. As you have been blessed with the mark of God's love, you are now called to go out from this place and bless others. May the God who created you create opportunities for serving others. May the Christ who teaches you teach you during